Recognize folks, point people out, and welcome them as you always miss somebody. Joel, how can I miss you? Amen. We're glad that you're here this morning. Thank you. Excited this morning to bring to this pulpit Dr. James Hughes, no stranger here. Of course, he knows how to make himself at home. We appreciate that so very much. He's quite in demand, travels all over, really all over the world, and has been to China, all over the I don't have a desire to go to China, but he's been there ministering the word of the Lord. And really, he could be anywhere he wanted to be today. And I appreciate him coming to hometown America. Amen. And I've got a little clue for you. I think he kind of likes it here. I want him to come. Let's give him a big awesome welcome. You don't have to, when he gets through, you don't have to wonder what he said. He's going to make it very plain today. The key is that we apply it to our hearts where it's applicable today. Would you lift your hands again and just ask God to speak to your spirit today as he comes for Jesus.
We thank you today, Jesus. There is none like you. What a privilege to be in your presence today. We worship the name that's above every name. We give you glory and honor today. I bless you, Jesus. While you're standing, if you have your Bibles, turn with me to the book of 1 Corinthians. Let me begin reading verse 17. We'll read two verses. For Christ sent me not to baptize, but to preach the gospel, not with the wisdom of words, lest the cross of Christ should be made none effect. For the preaching of the cross is to them that perish foolishness, but unto us which are saved, it is the power of God. Yeah. Verse 23. For we preach Christ crucified, to the Jews a stumbling block, unto the Greeks foolishness. But unto them which are called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ, the power of God, and the wisdom of God. For a few moments this morning, I want to talk to you about the power of the cross. The Lord bless you and may be seated. Before I begin today, let me say today what an incredible honor it is to be here. And I will have to agree with your pastor that this is hometown America. It's just good to be here. Actually, it's good to get out of the rat race and just enjoy relaxing a little bit, being in the presence of the Lord.
Amen.
See, the presence of the Lord is when you're with your brothers and sisters that are part of the family. Wherever we go, we can be in His presence.
Yes.
So it's just an honor to be here today. It's such an honor to be with Brother Sister Rhodes. I have grown to have a lot of respect and love for them and their family. What incredible people. I have some very dear friends that I've known for a long time, actually 40-something years, that only recently did I discover they were even connected to you folks. I think last year when I was here, or maybe it was the year before that, I noticed all the arrowheads on Brother Rhodes' desk and asked him where he got them. And he told me where they came from. Brother Archer, and they've been part of our lives 40-something years. You just never know how you're connected to people. What an honor to be here today. Back at the end of last year, actually it was the New Year's Eve Sunday, my brother made a request. I was home that weekend, and so he asked if I would teach on communion that Sunday night because they were going to have a communion service afterward. As I begin to study the Word of God, I refresh some things that I had discovered before as I was studying, and I'm not sure what drew my attention to it, but as I was studying for communion, I just kind of remembered some of my feelings I had as a kid growing up in church. And I remembered some of those experiences that we had on Watch Night Service, because every New Year's Eve, all the churches within 50 miles of where I live would get together and we'd have quite a service that night. There would be at least five preachers that preached. We'd start at 7, but it'd be 12 or 1 o'clock before we finished. And we came to church and worshiped, and we always did communion. And it wasn't uncommon for us to do foot washing, which we just totally abandoned today. You know, that's, for some reason, we don't recognize that humbling ourselves to someone else is part of being a child of God. So I remember as a kid hearing the preacher prepare us for communion. And they would use terms and words that terrified me as a child. I was terrified to take communion, because I was, at least my translation of what was being said. Now, I understand that probably not what they were saying, but my childish mind, hearing what was being said, made me believe that if I did it and I didn't have everything out of my heart, then God would not like me anymore. And I was going to be in serious trouble with God. And as I began to really look at what communion was all about, you see, Paul had to stop them here at Corinth because they had made it a party. It was a time everybody got together and broke bread and had fellowship and then had communion. So their version of communion was nothing like ours, because when you announce communion, most people get scared. We approach it with this attitude that we're blemished and any problem we've got in our life, that this is God's going to judge us for it, and we make the cross of none effect if we take it. As I began to study, it reminded me of what I had studied years before, but I had never had the opportunity to ever share it. And so as I was studying communion and talking to church that night, I realized that the purpose of communion, first of all, is not what we think it is. Communion, and when I take communion, is me saying to my world that I believe in the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. Amen. And Jesus said, "This do in remembrance of me." So when I do this, it's saying to my world and to myself, I have faith in Jesus Christ. And I believe that Jesus died and rose again for me. Not for the world, but for me. And I am stating to my world that I believe in Jesus Christ. It is a public confession. I believe in the death, burial, and resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. It is not time of guilt and shame. Guilt and shame have been manufactured by humans, not God. Guilt and shame are what human beings have come up with, not God. Guilt and shame will not change you. Guilt and shame never makes a drunk change his habits, a drug addict change his habits. Guilt and shame has never given anyone the courage or the ability to change their life and become something different. God never uses shame to control us. Now, the law did bring shame, and man learn to use the law as a weapon to control people. That was never God's purpose. The purpose of the law was just to remind us that these are the conditions God wants us to live our life by. It wasn't a way to keep people out of God's presence or make people afraid to come to God. The law was given to give man an awareness of what sin was, so he would know emphatically what sin was classified as. It was not to be used as a whip to drive men or to control men or to dominate men. It was used to give me a knowledge there are things in my life I need to change. See, at God's house, God uses conviction, not guilt, not shame. Because conviction has a remedy where guilt and shame have no remedy. When God convicts you and you recognize you've sinned, there's always a blood covering to get you out from under the curse of sin. There's always a redemptive quality that allows your life to become better or change from what it was before. Guilt and shame just keeps you bound and you never change because there's no way out.
Right.
Actually, guilt and shame is the product of self-condemnation. And self-condemnation has no remedy. When God touches us, it's to change us. That's why Paul writes in the Roman letter that there is therefore now no condemnation to them that walk uprightly after Christ. They're not following flesh, but they choose to walk differently. There is therefore now no condemnation. And if I use guilt to control you about taking the body of Christ, I'm causing you to miss its purpose. When Paul tells the Corinthians, don't take the Lord's Supper unworthily. The word unworthy is not anywhere close to our word. So we use our language to control people when that's not what Paul said at all. See, our word worthy implies that you have done something good enough to deserve what you are doing or what you are receiving. The Greek word worthy is asios or axios, and it comes from the marketplace. It is a term used to describe the purchasing of an item at market. You bring your fruit, your meat, your vegetable to the owner of the market. He sets a scale on the table. You put what you're buying on one side of that scale. He puts weights on the other side. When the bar is level, you have paid a worthy price. It literally translates to level the bar or to bring in the balance. So when you find the word unworthy in the New Testament, there is no Greek word unworthy, but you can make it by simply adding an alpha or an alpha nu in front of a word if it begins with a vowel or a consonant. An alpha if it's a consonant, an alpha nu if it's a verb or a vowel. And so the word is anasios, which means out of bounds. Has nothing to do with what you're doing with your life and whether you've been a sinner or not. It has to do with, are you doing anything to keep yourself balanced? This is about balancing your relationship with people, with God. It's about learning how to not become an extremist in anything you do. You know, I hear people make a statement, they pray 4 hours, and instantly my antenna goes up and think, oh wow, you got a real problem. Because I guarantee you, you didn't spend 4 hours in the Word of God. So 4 hours of prayer without 4 hours of the Word of God means you're out of balance. And when you do that, you start finding out all kinds of things and all kinds of revelations start happening as a result of not balancing your life. So God don't shame us into living for Him. He He loves us into living for Him. I don't shame my children to get them to come to my house, because I guarantee you, if I did, they would never show up. If I can create an atmosphere of love that they don't find anywhere else, they want to come there. Not based on shame or guilt. Remember several years ago, the school my children were attending was a private Christian school. And, you know, kids are going to be kids. And kids are going to do some really dumb things. You give an opportunity, they'll do dumb things. So, don't be shocked at how dumb they are, okay? That's just kids. They're not mature. So, one of these bright young men one day convinced the teacher to let him borrow the key to get something out of the closet that he needed. And in the process of getting it out of the closet, he took the key off the key ring. Gave a setback for her. She's not aware she's missing the key. So that afternoon he goes to the local hardware store and has a copy of it made. And the next morning at first of class, he needs something else out of the closet. And so he puts the key ring or the key back on the ring. And now he's got a copy. Now inside that closet are score keys and test keys. And every so often he goes in when no one's paying attention, takes a few out, takes them to the copy machine and photocopies. And now he's peddling scores. Now that's what kids that sit on pews do. Your kids don't have halos. They weren't born an angel. They ain't come to this world good people. They came in this world screaming at everybody in the room. And they've been screaming ever since. First emotion shows up in your life is anger. You show up mad at the world. You scream at everybody around. You're not nice. Hopefully you give instructions that get them out. And so, you know, the scripture emphatically says, beware, lest thy sins will. So he got caught. Well, he didn't get caught. Someone else got caught with a copy. And when pressure was put on, they revealed the source. And before long, they discover that probably the entire class, except one person, has either used information they heard or had one of those things in their hand that they memorized the answer. You know, when everybody in class starts getting 100 on every test, something ought to happen instantly. Let everybody know we got a problem. Yes.
Yeah.
So, when they get caught, they're punished. And I happened to drive up to school that afternoon to pick my children up, and I walked in, and I just noticed there was this heavy atmosphere in this place. It was like everybody there died. I mean, it was the worst kind of environment you ever walked in. Now, looking around, thinking, what in the world's going on here? My son come out. His face is sad, and he got his head down. We start out the door, and he just burst out crying. And I said, Anthony, what is wrong? He said, Dad, I have ruined your name. I said, you did what? I ruined your name. So wait a minute, Anthony. Who told you ruined my name? Well, that's what they told us that we had embarrassed our parents and ruined their name. So Anthony, If my name is that fragile, I don't have a name to start with. There is no way you're going to ruin my name. You can't ruin the name of Jesus. Your behavior is not going to ruin his name, because his name is above every name. And when you make mistakes, but this is what religion has taught us. And religion has convinced us that you use guilt and shame to control people, to manipulate people, to get what you want out of people, to control them or get them to do what you want them to do.
Right.
So we've used shame to get people to do things. We're good at it. We learn how to use guilt. Matter of fact, I think it was Ray Stevens that wrote a song about I'm giving guilt for Christmas, because it's the gift that goes on and on and on. Just never dies. Why would God relate to us that way? Why would we dare insinuate? That's how God felt about humans.
Yeah.
The book emphatically says, Jesus declared, I have come to seek and save that which was lost.
Right.
He didn't come for good people. He came for all people.
Yeah.
You see, if you, y'all listen to me, I'm going to irritate you right now, but you just listen to this old man. If you can't see a pedophile in heaven, then your Jesus is mean.
True.
He has the power to heal and forgive no matter what a person's done. I don't get the control. I have no say-so in who he lets in heaven, because his blood has the power to cover sin, not only mine, but the sin of the whole world. And so it doesn't matter what I can, what I've done. The blood of Jesus Christ is able. He didn't come just for good people, but he come for people that are sinful. You see, there are, matter of fact, there was a young lady I got connected to as a result of what I was doing, that heard her husband came to me one day and said, she was just weeping. She said, my brother is going to be executed tomorrow. Raised in church, got out of church, got involved in drugs, and as a result of high, three people lost their life. And now he's going to pay. And they had gone to visit him, and he had told them, please don't cry for me. What I did deserves the punishment I'm about to get. But I just want you to know that when the pastor from town where this prison was at came to visit him several months before, he said, we started praying, and the Lord refilled me with the Holy Ghost. Now my behavior is going to cause me some problems.
Right.
But I'm going to be put to death for what I did. But my relationship with God is back where it should be.
Right.
And he's forgiven me of my sin. And he's forgiven me of what I have done. But I do have to pay the consequences of my behavior. So don't ask this be changed, or they'll give me a stay, or their governor grant me the right of a pardon, or life in prison without parole. Don't ask for any of that, because this is what I deserve for my behavior.
Right.
I take ownership of my life. I caused that problem. No one else did. It was my behavior of leaving God, getting out of church, getting involved in drugs. I can't blame drugs for it, because I chose to do it. But I'm going to pay the price. But I just want you to know that the Lord has refilled me with the Holy Ghost, and that I am comfortable with what's going to happen.
Right.
See, God's not willing that any should perish.
No.
Right. Not any.
No. That's right.
But all come to repentance.
Yeah.
God don't use guilt or shame to control me or get me to relate to Him. And as I was studying, I noticed this passage of Scripture, because this issue about communion comes up in the Corinthian letter, and it's here that Paul says, don't take the Lord's Supper unworthily, because of their attitude that they've made it this big party. And he said, it's not a party. It's not something you do to get drunk. This is something you do in reverence, but it's not to bring shame to you or guilt to you. It's to let you know, and you to let your world know, I believe in the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. It's your greatest statement of faith that you have, because you're not just saying the words, you're doing an action that proves you're putting your behavior where your words are. And I believe in Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection.
Yes.
It's my public statement of faith.
Amen.
But as I got studying the cross, I'm probably going to confuse you a little bit this morning, and please hear me out, and don't just listen to part of what I'm saying, because some of the things I'm going to say today might cause you a little problem. So listen carefully, please. When people tell me what I've said or preached, I often wonder, where were you at when I was preaching? Because I didn't say anything close to that. So don't interpret what I'm saying. Listen to what I'm saying.
All right.
Come on.
Good.
Your sin did not put Jesus on a cross. Now that's what the world has convinced us of. That's what religion has convinced us of. But that's not what the Word said. Prophecy said that He would be wounded our transgression. Isaiah 53, verse 5. He was wounded for our transgression. He was bruised for our iniquity. The chastisement of my peace was upon Him, and with His stripes we are healed. That didn't happen at the cross. That happened in Pilate's hall, tied to a whipping post.
Right.
Yeah. In Pilate's hall, He was scourged for your sin. In Pilate's hall, the chastisement of your peace was put upon Him. And the stripes that were laid there were for the healing of your body, your soul, your mind, your spirit. Every aspect of your life was why those stripes were put on His back. For your healing, He was beaten. But Paul declared, for the joy that was set before Him, He endured the cross. The Scripture implies and lets us know that when He got to the cross, soldiers didn't have to throw Him on the cross and put a knee in one palm and a knee in another palm and hold His feet in place. Actually, when He got to the cross, He crawled on that cross and stuck one hand out, then stuck the other hand out and allowed them to place His feet where they needed to be. Your sin didn't nail Him to a cross. Your value nailed Him to a cross. He didn't die because you were broke and worthless. He died because you were His greatest creation, and that He had been waiting for 4,000 years to hold that creation again. And if He could just escape that body He was living in, then eternal redemption would show up, and He could save mankind from their sin if He just simply gave His life. So when He got to the cross, the joy that was set before Him was that now He could hold you again.
Yes.
He didn't go there because you was worthless. He didn't go there because you were a nobody. The power of the cross is that at get a revelation of how valuable you are to God, not how worthless you are to God.
Amen.
When you go to the cross, your past is not plugged up. Your future appears.
Amen.
When you go to the cross, you're not going to see where you came from. You're going to see where you go. Deliver you, because you won't be controlled by guilt and shame anymore. You'll be controlled by the value I place inside of you.
Amen. Amen.
Jesus had died because you're sorry and you're worthless and you can't do anything right. He came to show you that that's the lie that Satan has told you. That's the lie the world has fed you. It may even be the lie that your family taught you, but it is not the truth about who he is and who you are. You see, angels can't have redemption because they're not his most prized possession. What's the most valuable thing to God is what he created that's like him.
Yeah.
Because he made you in his image. He put his creating nature inside of you. He gave you the ability to create answers to solve problems. He didn't give angels the ability to solve problems. They're just ministering spirit. They don't have problem solving skills.
Right.
But he put himself inside of you.
Yeah.
Now listen to me. There is no excuse for you saying, I don't know how.
Right.
You like that? There is no excuse for you whining and saying, I can't. Because the creative genius of God lives inside of you.
Yes.
And you create answers to anything you want to create answers to. Just get off your lazy backside and start creating.
Right.
Quit complaining that you can't and start doing it, because Paul said, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Well, there's nothing I can do about this. You don't understand. I've got an addictive personality. You don't let the world lie to you. God didn't give you an addictive personality. They never give you a disease, because if you don't have a disease, they can't collect the insurance.
Yeah.
You don't have an addictive personality. You just like it or you quit.
Right. That's right. That's right.
You blame it on spirit, and the instant you do, well, there's a spirit involved. Then they don't have to change.
Yeah, right.
What's making everything devils?
Yeah.
Instant you make a devil out of something, you take a human's responsibility away from them.
Right.
And they can't help themselves, because there's a spirit involved. There's no spirit of homosexuality. There's no spirit of addiction or alcohol or drugs. It's a person's choice.
Right.
Why? They haven't been to the cross. They're living under guilt and shame.
Yeah.
I can get you to a cross and give you a revelation of who you are. You'll never be addicted again. You'll never have any junk in your life again. But you'll discover that he sees me not broke, but alive and well.
Yes.
When you go to a cross, don't go there thinking he's gonna bring my sin. No. That happens at an altar. You're supposed to do that when you're coming. It's one of the altars at the front door of the church in the Old Testament. So you die coming in. When you die coming in, you get all the junk out of the way. But when you get inside, you don't have your past drug up. Because Paul declared, I'm the chiefest of sinners. There's nobody worse sinner than me. But he didn't let his past dictate his present or his future. And that old man in prison, as I told the ladies, probably not chained to Nero's trained assassins, said, forgetting those things which are behind, reaching towards those things. See, he'd been to the cross. He understood that the cross was the power of God and the wisdom of God. At the cross, you're going to discover how powerful he is. Andrew Newberg, in studying human brains, has discovered that when you speak in tongues, the language center of your brain don't work. So part of your brain that controls tongue and vocal cords, by the way, Andrew Newberg, he's not religious of any kind. He's raised by an atheist. But he discovered that when you speak in tongues, your language center don't work anymore. But what works is your sensory perception. It's like every nerve on your skin has been stroked all at the same time. It's like God just wrapped himself around you. And you feel him in every pore, every nerve cell, every nerve in you. It's triggered because you're being moved on by God. Adam only got to hear God talk because God walked with him every day. But you and I get to have God living inside of us. He's just not on the outside. He's on the inside as well. And when you put God inside of you, he's never used guilt or shame to get you to change. He just starts showing you a better way. Son, look, you're not broke. You're a diamond. You're a vessel of honor. You're a masterpiece. You're not defective. Don't let the world around you convince you you're worthless. You can't do anything right. You're just a miserable wreck. Because that's not who you are. Who you are is the creation I created you to be. And as the psalmist said, I am fearfully and wonderfully created is the exact word. David, without the aid of an electron microscope, not knowing what a human cell looked like, described in the Psalms 4,000 years ago. And he writes, in your book, you wrote all my members, when as yet there was none of them. Psalm 131. In your book, at the instant of conception, God takes out a pen and writes the details of your life. God is not shocked that at 67, James Hughes has sagging skin and a lot of missing hair and bumps and blemishes that didn't used to be there. He's not shocked by the wrinkles. He's not shocked by anything in my life because in his book, he wrote all my members. Whereas yet, at the instant of conception, see, God chose chromosomes that made you. You don't like when your nose is out? Then you're doing injustice to God by saying, God, I don't like what you made. Out of the billions of possibilities that you could be, God chose chromosomes that put together your DNA that made you look like you look. And he detailed in his book. You know, if you didn't have a mirror, you'd have no clue your nose wasn't even worth what you like. You understand that?
That's right.
So you're letting an outside influence convince you. See, I don't have to deal with what I look like. You do, so get over it. I can't sin. I don't have a clue what it looks like. I just hope it's a little presentable. Maybe it's not. I don't know. I can't control that. So why am I going to let my world convince me that every old bar needs a coat of paint because it's defective?
Right.
Why am I going to let my world convince me if I change the outside, it makes the inside a lot better?
All right.
Change the package, put a bigger ribbon on it. It'll make the inside much better. No. I'm not going to change the inside at all. But if I can take you to a cross, I can change the inside.
That's right.
I can get you into the presence of the Lord Jesus Christ. He's not going to show you how bad you've been. He's going to show you what incredible thing you can do if you'll just let Him take you places He wants. He's not going to affect your life. He's going to give you the best life you can ever talk to Him about. Amen. When God's kids truly discover they're not broke, they change the world because they start letting God shine through.
Right.
When you think all you are is a mistake, then God can't shine through.
Right.
But the day you get a revelation that He don't make junk,
that's right.
He's never said, oops, messed that one up. No. We're His masterpiece. Not broke. Don't let the world convince you. Let the cross convince you. Yes. Don't be afraid of the cross because it's the power of God. The cross is the power of revelation. The cross is the power of victory. It's at the cross. Remember the old song we used to sing, at the cross? At the cross.
Yeah.
When I first what?
Oh,
now what happened to it? Why did we quit singing those songs? Well, the burdens of my heart, what? It was thereby I received my
sight.
Now I what? See, y'all quit singing that song because I don't see happiness.
Yeah.
It's at the cross. At the cross. When I first saw.
Yes.
Amen.
When you come to the cross, you're not walk away feeling like you're a nobody.
Right.
You'll discover that your Father's the King of Kings.
Oh, yes.
And the Lord of Lords. Gracious Father, thank you today for your incredible presence that you have here today. Lord, thank you for ministering to lives today. Thank you for interrupting us to move and touch someone's life today. We thank you, Lord, that you feel comfortable enough around us that you can come in and change the atmosphere, change what we're doing, and change our plans. You can just interrupt for a few moments because what you do in seconds is more than we can do in a lifetime.
Right.
So Lord, I thank you today for your interruption and for your touch in some hearts here today.
Thank you.